Welcome, one and all, to Neo Reality Thoughts. I'm back again with the next Thoughts video, and it's a match that everyone's been wanting me to talk about. Mostly me, sorry. And as you can see, I'm using a stand here for this because this is a special recording. I'll get to that when I can. But we're here to talk about the match that many people still say is one of the greatest matches in New Japan Pro Wrestling, and in fact, in the IWGP Intercontinental Championship history, and that, my friend, is AJ Styles, the phenomenal one of Bullet Club, and Shinsuke Nakamura of New Japan Pro Wrestling's King of Strong Style and Leader of Chaos. Yeah, I'm still bugged by that part. Like, Okada's supposed to be the perfect face, and yet he's a part of a faction known as Chaos. Well, whatever floats their boat. Anyway, so I just had to increase the audio input so you would hear me better. But since I'm doing it from a more further distance with this microphone, but anyways. So now we're here to talk about Shinsuke Nakamura versus AJ Styles, New Japan Pro Wrestling's premier event, Wrestle Kingdom 10, and retrospect on that match. So the match, well, this was the first time they've ever fought in a singles match. They've had previous tag team outings. They met in tag team action. But as a full-fledged one-to-one match, nope. Never until Wrestle Kingdom 10. And this match had no build-up in the traditional sense. It's more like Nakamura, after he had defeated Carl Anderson at Power Struggle, announced he would take an open challenge for anyone for the IWGP Intercontinental Championship. And that guy so happened to be AJ Styles. He came out, claims that he'll get it. And in fact, that's the image you're seeing right now on the screen here. And he said that he would go after and take the title from AJ Styles. And then from Shinsuke Nakamura. And when I was watching the preview video in the match on New Japan World, it feels like I'm watching a very different Shinsuke Nakamura than the one we get. Like, I don't know what the heck he's saying because I don't speak Japanese or understand it, but it just feels the confidence, the swagger to it. It just feels like that I'm looking at a much different Nakamura than the one we have now in WWE that's doing very little with the Intercontinental title of their brand because, I don't know, they don't want it to surpass the world titles or the universal title, or as I like to call it, the Brock Lesnar title. Oh, no, and that's the universal title. That's Bray Wyatt's title. I mean the Brock Lesnar title. That's the WWE title that has 50 years of history, but screw history. We gotta reboot that eventually. So, yeah. So after Shinsuke Nakamura got the open challenge accepted by AJ Styles, a press conference was officially made to declare the match official, and then Styles suddenly got injured and almost looked like he couldn't make it from a back injury during the end of the year World Tag League due to this back injury, but it was announced that he would return at Wrestle Kingdom. This would mark the first singles match between Nakamura and AJ Styles, with the two having previously met in tag team matches from August 2008 to November 2015. So yeah, so think about this. New Japan capitalized on the first ever AJ Styles and Shinsuke Nakamura match, and there wouldn't be another match for this between the two for another 2 years till WrestleMania. Kind of shows you where they were going with this. But yeah, I'll get to the comparison. Like, everyone looks at the WrestleMania match as the inferior version for various reasons. But I'll talk about a little bit of that while talking about the Wrestle Kingdom match, because everyone calls that the best match that Nakamura and Styles ever had together compared to WrestleMania, Backlash, Greatest Royal Rumble, SmackDown Out of Nowhere, Money in the Bank. Yeah, they had a ton of matches. They almost had a six match. Originally, they were going to have Nakamura defeat Styles for the WWE title, but then Vince changed his mind at the last minute because, of course, and it was going to lead into a six match, probably into SummerSlam, and then, oh boy. Luckily, they didn't do that because everyone was sick of that match already. Like, New Japan waited their time, 2008 all the way up to 2016. And then WWE's like, okay, we waited 2 years for this. Let's go, 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 go. anyways, Nakamura and Styles matchup. So when I was watching this match and deconstructing it bit by bit, I watched moments of it, and then I went back to rewatch some clips of the next encounter, which would be at WrestleMania, and I noticed. And then immediately I started noticing something off regarding the WrestleMania match when compared to the Wrestle Kingdom match. It felt like, whereas in the Wrestle Kingdom match, I look at this match like a three-act structure, a movie-like structure from here. Here's the best way to sum up the entire match between Nakamura and Styles Wrestle Kingdom and Nakamura and Styles of WrestleMania. Wrestle Kingdom felt like a three-act structure, cohesive, directed, and very well put together, whereas WrestleMania's was, okay, they were like told, okay, remember how you did so well in the first act and built it up? Okay, now let's get rid of all that good stuff and just make the second act completely like the first act, like we just started, then get into high gear, and then just stop the match. That was, like, the biggest comparison I can make. So, Nakamura and Styles do their iconic moment where Styles points the gun at Nakamura with his gun finger, and Nakamura just catches it. And I'm thinking, oh, God. Like, and then when I was watching this match, I was like, you know, this is why I kind of miss Nakamura from the independent scene. Heck, I hoped he would sign with AEW, since he did say he did not want to go back to Japan. He wanted to be staying in the U.S., especially in Florida, where his family is now. And I was like, just go to AEW. They have a promotion. They have some guys you can work with. They have people you have history with. You could work with these guys. Heck, I want to see Kenny Omega versus Nakamura. But Nakamura resigned for reasons I'll never understand, even though he was clearly going through just phoning in his performances at this point. I get his age, but still. So, and I loved a lot of the psychology built into this match. Like, I loved every moment of this matchup. Like, there were moments you did feel like it could go the other way, and then you heard the uncertainties regarding Styles and where Nakamura was going, and then you had AJ Styles just being this dastardly heel, using his back injury as a way, while he really does feel pain in his back, he uses it as his ultimate weapon to try and take down Nakamura, targeting his neck, and Nakamura striking down the back, once again proving that Gato, for some reason, has borrowed Vince McMahon's weird fetish of target the injured area that people just got back from. Because, I don't know. Also, AJ Styles' entrance was awesome. It was simple, and it only had his Bullet Club mask on, which was awesome. And then, like, every time when I was watching this match, I did feel like I was watching a very different match than what we got with WrestleMania. Like, I was trying, like, I kept, like, I wanted to enjoy this match just for this match, but part of me was always going back to that WrestleMania match, trying to analyze it, deconstruct it, and try and grasp at what made this one so iconic to fans, whereas the WrestleMania match was not as great or as it could have been. And then I think I finally got it. Well, there are a multitude of things about the match that was different from the later match he would have, was that Styles was a heel face, Styles was a heel here, there were factions at the time between the two. This was a first time ever match, and New Japan's structure was like pure wrestling at its finest, whereas WWE's structure is storytelling, character stuff. And then you have to remember that they also had various agendas running the show, because you had Brock Lesnar's match with Roman Reigns, because that was the big match. They wanted that match to be the most important. They wanted it to be the best quality. So they were telling basically Styles and Nakamura to not put as much effort in, because if they did, it would overshadow Roman, and we can't have that now, can we? And whereas, I felt like when I watched Nakamura and Styles' match, it felt like I was watching a perfect three-act structure of a film. But whereas I was watching the WrestleMania match, I was thinking, like, I'm watching the first act, okay, we're getting into it. Then we go into the second act, and the match ends. What just happened? Yeah, like they were really getting into high gear in their second match in the second act, but then it just ends before they could do the third act. But yeah, one of the other big moments of this match was when Styles goes for the tries to do the alt super Styles clash. Yeah, because every time when you go on top of the turnbuckle to do your finishing move, it's always called super instead of ultimate. Like, I believe they called Randy Orton when he did it off the turnbuckle was super RKO. Even WWE does it, so sue me. But yeah, I also love the iconic bullet and then eats it moment. That's the most iconic moment for a lot of people. So, yeah, one of the more other moments in this matchup that I noticed was, whereas when I watch Styles and Nakamura's match at WrestleMania and I'm watching Wrestle Kingdom's matchup, I'm thinking, okay, how come, okay, I know these wrestlers are putting their bodies on the line for our entertainment, I get that, but why does it feel like the punches, kicks, and all the stuff they did in the WrestleMania match that they do in Wrestle Kingdom feel more deadlier and more cringing when you realize they're in terrible pain, whereas I'm watching the WrestleMania match and I'm not feeling the effect of the blow, I'm not feeling the effect of the chop or the kick. Like, even when Nakamura targeted Styles' head with the Kinshasa, as it's called in WWE, you hear a loud crack, like he just broke part of Styles' neck in the Wrestle Kingdom 10 match, and if that never happened for anyone else, and I'm the only one that heard that, I'm going to be straight up honest, I'm probably a morbid bastard on this. But, yeah, that's a completely different subject. So, yeah. Now, you got that quality in there. Like, every time when Styles and Nakamura hit each other, I heard the cracks, I heard the punches, I heard them, I could feel them. But when I was looking at WrestleMania's match, I was thinking, I'm not feeling it. I'm not feeling the impact to it. It feels like they're trying to do it, but it's more like they're told not to do it because they don't want it to do it. Not because they don't want to, it's because they're told not to do it because we got to make Roman happy. We got to make Brock Lesnar happy because he's about to strong arm Roman and beat him up legitimately because he wants more money out of Vince. I still am mad about that incident. And then I noticed one other thing about Nakamura from WWE from New Japan. Nakamura doesn't have his iconic "Yow!" catchphrase. Like, he made that popular. Like, it could have been in "Yes, yes, yow, yow, yes, yes, yow, yow." Imagine if they did that. Daniel Bryan versus Nakamura, and they brought in the "yow" thing and made that a thing again in WWE's world. And then you got the "yes" chance versus the "yow" chance. But now that tradition is continued by Kota Ibushi, since he borrows the Kinshasa and a lot of Nakamura's style in the ring in order to honor him, because I don't know the connection, I don't know the relationship between Nakamura and Ibushi. I'm pretty sure they were close. They did have a match at Wrestle Kingdom a year prior to Wrestle Kingdom 10, Wrestle Kingdom 9, I believe, for the IWIC title, but I don't know the full details of their friendship. I just know that they were probably really close, since Ibushi does carry on Nakamura's legacy in New Japan. Nakamura would launch two Kinshasas, the one I described when you hear the on the back of the head and to the neck, and the psychology and the anticipation you're feeling in your blood and your bones, and one more Kinshasa, Styles is out, and Nakamura gets the 1-2-3, and then afterwards, when they finally get their bearings straight, they fist bump each other like the Shield would used to do, and that ends their match, and it's a classic for a lot of reasons for people. A lot of people love this match to this day. I knew this match was already quality. I've always heard the stories about it. It was everything I thought it would be, because I had never watched it up until a certain point. But I always heard that this match was praise, this match was a genius storytelling, this match was simple, short, and simple and effective. It was like, and then I finally got what made this so different. The one definitive thing that makes it different from the WWE's version of doing this. WrestleMania's one felt like it didn't have a passion to it. There was no fire in it. Like, I'm not saying they didn't try their best. They did, and they had fire to it, but I'm saying, like, it wasn't there. The fire that you got from the Wrestle Kingdom match, it just wasn't there. The crowd didn't know their history in terms of New Japan, because casual fans, for the most part, in their eyes, don't watch, and people in the hardcore subjective viewpoint, that they don't watch New Japan Pro Wrestling. They're not up late watching New Japan. They're not up early in the morning watching New Japan. They don't subscribe to New Japan. So they don't know this history between them. They have to try and explain it. But when WWE tries to explain it, they try to gloss it up. They try to hide certain stuff, like, oh, it happened. And it happened in Japan. We don't want to say the other name because we don't want to give promotion to them. So it's like, okay, so they had a match in Japan. Where exactly? Yeah, when you have a company that is very set in this whole, we need to be as not transparent as possible with the other companies and treat like this only exists, like Jerry Lawler said about Styles, that if it didn't happen in WWE, it just didn't happen. Which was the perfect summation of the entire corporate problem. Also, by the way, the WWE is currently struggling, had just fired two of their big co-presidents, so that's a big seismic shift happening. So, Nakamura and Styles, they also at Wrestle Kingdom, the one other thing that people talk about is which match stole the show. This match or Hiroshi Tanahashi versus Kazuchika Okada for the IWGP Heavyweight Championship. That's still debated by fans to this day. It reminds me of when I say it could be strongly debated between, did Roman Reigns and Bray Wyatt steal the show, or did Undertaker and Brock Lesnar steal the show in their Hell in a Cell matches? Yeah, that's saying something when you got something working here. The other big moment that happens after this was when Styles, Nakamura, both gave their notices and announced their big detention to departure in New Japan Pro Wrestling to head to WWE. AJ Styles would be gone after New Year Dash when Bullet Club turned on him, led by Kenny Omega usurping his role as the leader, because even though Styles didn't see himself as the leader, he said that constantly in interviews, saying, I was never leader of Bullet Club. Everyone else looked at it as like, you're the leader, man. You're the top foreigner, and Omega's the next foreign guy to take your place. Then you have the heavyweight title, and the fact that, well, you were always seemingly calling the shots. And Nakamura would leave that same week as well, handing in his title. From what was said, apparently none of the changes to the match, like Carl Anderson and Luke Gallows' match, Nakamura's match with Styles, none of the endings were changed. They went exactly as planned. So it was still their vision, and they weren't going to do this BS finish where they were going to go ahead and just screw everyone over. They just said they wanted out. Fine to buy us. But, like, I'm pretty sure losing both Nakamura and Styles especially was a huge blow, because Nakamura helped reevaluated their IC title, and Styles was their top guy for the foreign markets. Now they had to really build up Kenny Omega. That gave Kenny Omega his big moment, and we all know what happens with Kenny Omega when it comes to the IC title. But, yeah. Those were my thoughts on Shinsuke Nakamura versus AJ Styles at Wrestle Kingdom 10. Classic match. Really would recommend for those who haven't watched it, go watch it. This was Neo Reality Entertainment. If you like, comment, subscribe, and donate, stay tuned for more. Oh, wait. There is something else I didn't mean to talk about. If anyone's been noticing, there's a box behind me. Screw it. Let's do it. Let's do the first ever unboxing video here. And this was my first attempt, so I'm sorry if it's terrible. But, yeah. Yeah, I'm sorry I'm not showing you the unboxing video. But, yeah, it's been a long time coming. Where is it? Oh, here, I just remembered. I ordered this a couple of weeks ago, honestly. Yeah, there's also a reason why I'm wearing the LIJ shirt for a various reason. For what holds in this box is nothing more than simply another box. Wow. I'm kidding. There's something in here. Let's see what it is. Let's see what it is. prepare to be amazed by gloriousness. Okay. So you're probably all wondering, what's in the box? What's in the box? See the big gold belt here? Well, you can just... Well, I'm not throwing this away. This cost a lot, and this is a special engraving I got for Christmas. Oh, you can throw that world title belt in the trash right now. I have found a superior masterpiece. Oh, that's right. I got it. The IWGP Intercontinental Championship. Oh boy, I bought this several weeks ago on eBay by Leather Belts. This is not a sponsored video, just telling you the facts. And oh boy, let's see the designs here. Oh boy, this is really beautiful. It's not as the overly complicated version that's around, but it is pretty aesthetically good. Oh man, this is pure brass metal, thick leather, quality, has quality engraving. It doesn't have the big gemstones that it's known for, but, there are gemstones on here, but not like some of the ones on top of the logo of the New Japan Bear, but... the white leather strap, oh my god. Oh boy, I've been waiting for this for 2 weeks. Oh man, I can sincerely say that this was worth it. Just taking a look at the quality. Yeah, it's pretty good. This was made by Leather Belts. It's based here in the U.S. They're on eBay. They also have a bunch of quality other belts, mock belts, bootleg belts. But I had wanted this title for a little bit, and I just found a replica that was a quality of CERN's, and I said, fuck it, I'm going to try and get it. It's on Leather Belts. It's for... $149 and with shipping costs, so that makes it $180 for the most part. No, wait, $160 something, and I got it for $29.99 as well, for shipping costs. And I gotta say, the results are pretty good. Yeah, I know it's not white leather strapped on the back, but yeah, this is a quality belt. Oh, for me, I say I made a right purchase with this, and this is real leather from what I was told, and. Okay, so let's take a look at how quality assurance this goes in here. Trying to figure this out. I haven't done this type of belt strapping in a while. I don't really use the studs, so forgive me if I don't really strap it around me, because I don't do that. But yeah, these are pretty hard to put in. But yeah, this leather looks pretty quality of standards. The design is pleasing to me. I am now the new IWGP Intercontinental Champion, and I got, by God, I say this, Twilinkilo wa Santana. Oh man, the wait was worth it. I was worried about this, in all honesty. Oh boy, sharp, crisp, I can see my reflection. Oh boy. Oh, this is gonna be awesome. Oh man, this is pretty cool. So now, I am the IWGP Intercontinental Champion. No one is taking this belt, okay? You hear me? Nobody. You hear me? Nobody is taking this title from me. I am now the IWGP Intercontinental Champion, and I can assure you, I damn well assure you, I will be the most proudest champion of all time. I will bring honor and prestige to this belt the way Tetsuya Naito, guys like Tetsuya Naito, Nakamura have brung it. I will bring it to a whole nother level, brother. Pardon my Hulk Hogan reference, I just had to. It just felt appropriate, even though I hate the guy. But now, we must move forward. These were my thoughts, and my special one-time-only, probably for the foreseeable future, unboxing video of the IWGP Intercontinental Championship. This was Neo Reality Entertainment. Feel free to like, comment, subscribe, and donate to TV for more. And rest assured, everyone, the champ is here! Oh, God, that was fun. See you all next time.